Well, how many of you are Ash vs. Evil Dead fans? Then please allow me to introduce, let's not waste any time, ladies and gentlemen, the executive producer of Ash vs. Evil Dead, Mr. Sam Raimi. Another executive producer, Mr. Rob Tapert. Mr. Ted Raimi. Dana DeLorenzo. Ray Santiago. Lucy Lawless. And the chin that roars, Mr. Bruce Campbell.
Thank you very much. We're not done yet with the introductions. The most important one is coming right now. We have a very special addition to the Ash vs. Evil Dead cast this year. Very special. This gentleman has starred in three different television shows that each went over 100 episodes. He needs no introduction, but I'm going to do it anyway because we're really happy to have him a part of this cast this year. Give it up. This is his first Comic-Con. Please welcome him, Mr. Lee Major!
And that's a $6 million intro. All right. We're going to have to do this because we're polite, but we're going to get through this fast. Sam, give us a little, where we ended at season one, give us a little recap of where we're about to start off with season two.
Well, Ash thinks that he's left it all behind him. As you know, he's made a trade, deal with the devil. He's shown a little bit of character growth, I guess just as much as Ash is capable of.
So emphasis on the word little?
Yes. And he's gone off to his home in Jacksonville, his dream home.
Mm-hmm.
And he thinks that he saved his friends. So at least he extended himself for those two, but he's made a much darker deal in the mix.
Hmm. Well, I have to ask you, Mr. Majors, what was it like joining this motley crew?
What? I'm sorry?
What was it like? What was it like joining Ash vs. Evil Dead?
It was a bloody good time. That's about it. We'll get into that later.
Well, I think we've seen a couple of hints of it. Now, Lucy, your character evolved a lot over the first season. What can you tell us about where she's at for season two?
Well, Ash actually bites the bullet and brings her into the family, much to the chagrin of Kelly and Pablo. But they have a sort of a weird trust relationship, and we'll see how that works out.
I have my doubts, personally. I don't trust Ruby as far as I can throw her. But I'll take her gas money.
Now, Ray and Dana, what has it been like for you guys? I mean, the way this season started out, again, I mean, if Lucy's character evolved, you guys jump-started to hell. What has it been like working with Bruce and working with Lucy?
Well, I'm sorry.
We're speechless.
Yeah, we're kind of taking, this is our first time here, so we're taking a moment to take it all in.
This is so exciting, you guys. And I just have to say, like, I just looked at Ray and just like, I have goosebumps. Like, you guys, I mean, really, the energy in here, this fan base for this franchise is incredible. I mean, thank you guys for giving us a job.
Yeah.
And thank you for putting us on the air.
But to sort of just answer what you were asking, I would say that, you know, we have these iconic leaders. And it's just an honor to go to work with them every day and to be able to listen and absorb everything that they do on set and to welcome us into the future of this franchise. So thank you. It's an honor every day to go to work with you guys.
Thank you very much. And Bruce Campbell is amazing. Bruce Campbell is the best person I have ever worked with in my life, and he is so funny.
We worked out a deal before I got here, babe. You're late.
No, but in all honesty,
your first Comic-Con and you got paid.
And I, nice. Hey.
Yeah.
No, but honestly, it's a testament to them as well, because I can't think of any other TV show that already has a history built into it. I mean, all of these guys have a 30-year friendship, longer, you know, than that. So the fact that they were so welcoming to Ray and I, as the fans were, I mean, we have so much fun on set. Like, I don't think people would even believe how much we actually laugh. And the minute Lucy laughs, she has this glorious cackle that you have to laugh. Like, I don't know if you've ever heard her laugh, but it's my, I'm going to make you laugh at some point so you can hear it. But we have a great time. So that's our answer.
So Ted, for you, you're coming back to the franchise. What's that been like?
Good.
Oh, you're going to be the low key guy on this. You
no,
and Lee
I'm
are going to compete
I
for the
just,
one word answers.
No, I'm not. It's great coming back. It's amazing coming back. It's the reason I'm a little hesitant is because, well, I see Bruce over there, and I've worked with him for 30 years. And just about this time, 30 years ago, Bruce lost a bit of money to me, and he hasn't yet paid it.
Wow.
How much
and that's
was
funny, because he's handing out green like crazy right now.
Yeah,
how
I know.
How much was
well,
it, Ted?
He wins and he loses. This was just one of the win times.
How much was it?
$20.
Oh, jeez.
Nice.
That's a hell of a guy, folks. I want to
By the way, the rest of you jerks, that's it. There's no more money.
Okay, Bruce, you guys, Sam and Bruce, you guys brought an iconic and classic film franchise to the small screen. What's it been like? You know, you had this season on Starz. You guys have been everywhere. Tell us what this ride's been like and where are we going forward?
Sam?
Yes, Bruce, we're ready to listen.
I don't have to say this, but I should. You know, Starz is the right place for this. If this was another feature film, it would be R-rated. They don't make $100 million unrated movies. You get my meaning here? So if you want unrestricted content, when we had our meetings, Sam was very clear that creative input was very important for us, and also having as few content restrictions as possible. And Starz had indicated to us that there were no content restrictions.
Yeah.
So honestly, if you think about it, as far as the amount of material that you would get, we make these movies once a decade. We made one in the 70s, one in the 80s, one in the 90s, and then we skipped a whole decade. Army of Darkness is 25 years ago, so... Yeah.
But I would say that from a historical standpoint, Bruce and I are the actors that have been here for 30 years, but these two guys, Dana and Ray, are the new faces and voices of the Evil Dead franchise, and I think that they are amazing.
Thank you.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. But let's talk. Get
go,
the money.
Ted. Here's
the
another 20.
Just flying around here.
This is a great day, I tell you. I love it here at Comic-Con.
But, Bruce, let's talk about you and Lee, because Lee plays your dad. Like, that's genius casting.
Yeah,
and
it
also,
is.
Yeah. It explains some issues that I've wondered about you for a while as well. But nonetheless, let's talk a little bit about that relationship and what we're going to see in season two.
Let's start with a visual. Lee, you and I were both men who were born with hair on our chest. We haven't gotten rid of it all like the modern day actors. Would you care to confirm that with me, Lee?
Yes.
Well, it was important to get Lee because Lee is the only other actor working in Hollywood who still has hair on his body. Well, that was important. Lee also, even though he's a very dutiful husband who's been married for 7,000 years. Before that, he was known as something of a player. Am I wrong, Lee? Would I be wrong to say that since I've met about four of your old girlfriends already? And so that's what you want. You want a guy who, after a while, after the first episode, you go, oh my God, that's where Ash got all of his bad habits.
Like father, like son. Like father, like son.
Exactly. So, I'm thrilled. It's exciting to work with a lot of different actors. All these schmoes, they're fine too. But, you know, look, this guy, what the hell? Lee Majors, get out of here. Everybody here grew up on this guy. Come on. And as long as I had the best dialogue, we were going to get along great.
Yes, boss. The only thing I dislike about the show is that I have to listen to him call me Pop. Other than that, and the blood, I'm not used to doing bloody shows, but when they asked me if I'd be interested in joining the show, I said, well, let me take a look at the first season, and I sat down and I viewed number one, and then I went to two, and then I ended up watching all 10 shows at one time, and I said, this is a hell of a fun show. I mean, who can't like
it? Yeah.
I didn't know that you could chainsaw somebody in two and throw out these funny lines and make it okay, you know? The blood and the gore is okay as long as you make it funny. And it is. He's an underrated actor. Lucy's a one. The chemistry of this whole cast is just wonderful, but Bruce is a very underrated actor. He can do comedy and everything.
This is preventative money, right?
All right.
Yeah.
Shake your money maker.
Yeah.
I could really use that.
Oh, no. That's for a little something else.
Yeah. No. We talked about more than that. Yeah. We talked about... Oh, you got a personal. Okay. Yeah. I got the square. I'm good. We could pay with that. All right, now, to talk about, you know, we just watched this trailer. A lot of hints in it, but Sam and I wanted to get a sense, how much have we amped up the volume going into season two? Because you guys were rocking it in season one. You know, as Bruce said, like, this is a, Starz kind of let you guys, they let you guys turn the floodgates on with the blood. So where are we going to go with season two?
I think season two has a lot more intensity, a lot more...
More intensity?
Yeah.
More intense. Oh, so people get, like, you guys sending out, like, helmets with people, like, so when they watch the show?
No, it's these viewers are ready for it. If they've experienced the first two Evil Dead movies, they know what to look for. They know what to feel for. And the great thing about Starz is they said, in fact, even in a conversation I had last night with them, they want to provide something that's not just out there, but that can't be found anywhere else on television, anywhere in cable. And they want it to be a unique experience so that nobody is producing anything like it. And I think that's the case. And I think the intensity of the second season helps push it in that direction. You know, it's got great comedy in it, I think, some really great Bruce-isms, great moments with his friends and their interactions. They go a little deeper than before. And then Ted comes into it.
and it all grinds to a halt.
Wait a minute.
but Lee is great in it. I think he's gonna bring a whole new dimension. And it goes a little deeper than before. We get to learn a little bit about Bruce's character through Lee, and you realize who he is and how he got to be the way he is. So it's really interesting after 35 years of this character to finally get deeper into him.
Well, we've never seen where Ash, you know, Ash is like a school teacher. Where does he live? You never see him out having dinner, having a cup of coffee. He's like this weirdo character. So he goes home. He's got a house. Crappy father. He has to deal with the problems in his hometown, as beautiful as Jacksonville, Florida is. Has anyone ever been there?
I've been to Jacksonville.
Oh, I'll speak more slowly.
You might want to speak very slowly. Lucy, but you know, we want to get to questions from you guys, because really, you don't fuck care what I think, what I have to ask. But Lucy, I did want to ask you, what was it like coming back to doing a television show after so long?
Oh, well, no, it's in something like three. In fact, there was an overlap of 2 months from my last show to this one. Yeah. I was shooting two shows at once, so it was fine. It was actually quite hard coming in because my character was not fleshed out, and it took us to like episode 9 to figure out what her last name was. And that was a bit tricky, but she's fully in this ferocious second season. She teams up with Kelly, actually. They've got a bit of a girl power thing going on. Yeah, she's having a little crisis of confidence, so Ruby's going to move in there and parent her a little. You know, help her along. It's very high octane, a lot of firepower.
All right, well, listen, we want to take questions from you guys. They've set mics up here, but honestly, just put your hand up if you want to ask a question, because we're going to take it from everyone. Okay, ma'am. And by the way, just one thing. One question each, and please say who it's for.
And stand up.
Right, yeah, Ruby's not much of a role model, actually. Nor was Lucretia. You think so? Yeah, she was a survivor, I like her. It's a great honor, and I take that responsibility very seriously. But Kelly's just, not Kelly, sorry.
Thanks.
Ruby is a mad dog. Yeah. Ruby's a lot of trouble, but she's her own worst enemy, and I want you to remember that by the end of the season that I said that, okay?
Yes, ball cap.
I have a question for Sam and Rob. So when you guys were funding the Evil Dead way back when, and you were going to dentists and doctors and getting money from them to, you know, you're pitching your movie to them, in this modern day and age, as a low-budget filmmaker, what kind of advice would you give someone like me to go out and do something similar to that? What's the most important part of pitching your film to people like that?
Oh, see, they're making you go to the mics, aren't they? Yeah.
You know what? So, you know my question, though.
The question was, as a young filmmaker, how do you sell yourself in order to get the money to make a movie? And it's never been harder and it's never been easier, because we still run across people all the time, and the best thing to raise money or to find yourself in the business is to have a showpiece to show somebody. So go out, however you have to do it, with your friends, with anybody you can, and get something shot, and use that as a stepping stone and a tool to and your calling card for what you can do. And that's how we met Fede Alvarez, who did the Evil Dead remake and just did Don't Breathe. He had a little 5-minute short on YouTube, and everyone came knocking on his door as soon as that thing came up, because you kind of saw, oh, well, that's a really interesting take on something. So film is its own best calling card.
I'd like to add to that, too. I completely agree with you, Rob, but the thing that gave Bruce, yourself, and myself our start was having each other. Having a friend or a partner that you trust that has similar interests, that can pick you up when you're down, and that can come up with the next ideas to where maybe we can scrounge up the next $5,000 to help our movie get along. That's more important, as important as the showpiece. They're both invaluable, but not to go it alone. It's great to have somebody to partner with.
Oh,
more questions.
Hi.
Why are you guys kneeling down?
Is
it for Bruce and Lee? I get that. They
hey,
like
don't
that.
Wait in line.
Bruce will hand out more money.
Don't wait in line. Sit down. Don't. Your questions aren't any more interesting than these schmoes over here. With all due respect, some schmoes over here ask a question. Don't.
Shoot, yeah, let's let that lady go first, because she was there.
All right, very well.
All right.
I came up here when no one else was willing to. I'm just saying, I started it.
I think it's very nice you guys are sitting so those guys can see. It's right. Really very kind of you.
Exactly.
You're like the most That's polite horror fans.
Why we do it. Why we do it. So I would just like to say, Bruce, your character is so iconic, and everyone here just loves it so much. How has it developed and created this iconic character for you? What's it like?
Ash is an anti-hero. He smokes angel dust this season. He drinks and drives. He's got a pile of crushed Shemp's beer cans in his back seat. He smokes reefer, drinks beer, drinks shitty whiskey, tries to get in the pants of most of the characters on the show. And I love that. I can't even tell you how much I love that. I'm so sick.
But you wouldn't recommend it for the children. There's so many children in the audience. Was the end of your
thing.
They're dressed like serial killers, Sam.
Yeah.
Yeah, look, their dad says it's fine.
I find the conventional hero, here, little Billy, here's your medicine back, to be Snoresville. I would rather have, here, little Billy, here's your medicine. Is your mom around? Right? I'm just more interested in that.
Have a nice sleep, Billy.
Yeah, Billy, have a nice long nap, why don't you? If you hear a bunch of noise, don't come through that door. You're going to need a lot more medicine after that. So I enjoy that type of a character much more because there's a lot, that guy can go places. There's a lot of room for improvement. If you're perfect from the start, where are you going to go? Down. I'd rather go up, incrementally. And by the way, if you want to see Ash develop, you need to convince Starz to greenlight season 3 and 4.
Yeah.
Because I know it'll happen. Because what'll happen is if they do that, if they give you that vote of confidence, you will not betray them. You will go, oh, it's a real show. And I can get to it when I get to it. But get to it sooner than later. And you have to get Starz. It's one thing to sit in here and go, you need to get the app, the Starz app, and you need to pay 13 blah, 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 whatever it is a month to get it. Otherwise, this is a meaningless episode right here today. It's what it's all about. Ratings make the world go round. And if it's not ratings, it's got to be improved subscriptions. And guess what? When you sign up, what are they going to ask you? Why are you subscribing to Starz? And you bet your ass you tell them Ash versus Evil Dead specifically. Because look, you think these people are stupid? They know that you're going to cancel that subscription as soon as the season is over. Unless they start doing other shows that you really like too. And then you'll be happy with that subscription. And I think they might start doing that. With your help. Thank you for your question.
All right. We're going to take a question from our little suicide squatter here.
Billy.
I just have to say you're one of the only reasons I come to Comic-Con. Oh,
no.
Thank you. You're amazing.
Oh. Oh.
Thank you.
Okay. Overlap. A lot of love there. You had a question. But who is it for? Yeah, you're well hooded up there, my little man. Yes.
How did you summon the demons?
How did you make the demons really pop out?
Well, they got you to come along, buddy. That's how they did it.
Do you mean on the first season of Ash vs. Evil Dead, something specifically on that?
But how did you make them really look like demons?
Again, I come back to they got Rob you to Tapert. Do it a little bit.
Rob, maybe you should answer.
You know what? We have a wonderful team of makeup effects people that... have worked for many years to create looks. So they come and they do some drawings and then we show them to Sam and myself and to Bruce and go, ooh, that's pretty scary. And then they go up and they paint the faces and they make prosthetics to put on people's faces. And that's how we kind of make the demons. So.
But hey, kid.
Starts with drawing.
Do those demons scare you? No? Then why did you ask the question? I think you're trying to make yourself feel better. How old are you?
10.
Why are you watching this show? Do you have parents here? Where are they?
Right there, there he is.
What the hell is wrong with you, man? You trying to make a serial killer? Huh? Is that what you're doing? Come here, kid. This is $20. I want you to clean that crap off your face and go get a job at the library, you understand?
And the $6 million man has put $20 under all your seats.
All right, there's a blonde lady over here. Yes, that's you. Yes, up. No, you just have to yell.
Do you want me to yell?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Could you say that again?
He said he wanted me to ask you if you would be in one of his movies and he would give you his firstborn child.
If I was in one of his movies, he'd give me... That's your father. You're already the firstborn child. Well, okay, let's make a deal. Do I get you or not? You don't have to answer now, but it better be yes. Your dad ain't getting shit. Tell him we'll talk later.
All right, sir, here in the middle. Stand up.
For Dana and Ray, you guys have both been a really natural addition to the cast, and I was wondering if you were fans of the franchise before and kind of what you did to prepare for your role.
Oh my God, that's such a good question. God. $20. $20.
Yes, in high school I saw Army of Darkness because I have now learned officially it is a rite of passage for every guy to see that movie and all of the Evil Dead movies. So for a long time, you know, I didn't, before I saw the movies in high school, every single guy would quote these one-liners, and I never knew where they were from. And then when I rewatched it, when I got the show, I was like, oh, okay, so that's why he called me a she-bitch. Okay, got it. totally makes sense now. Just quoting a movie, it's fine. But I will say, I started out loving horror when I was very young. I'm like horror buff for 10-year-olds, reading Goosebumps, every book, and Are You Afraid of the Dark, and all that. But something happened, I don't know, I get too scared now after I saw like The Shining, The Exorcist, and I watched Evil Dead 1 to prepare for this, and the 2, but 1. My God, it's from, you know, it's 30 years ago, it's not gonna be that scary. Oh my God, like I honestly am embarrassed to say that I do zero acting of being scared on this show. I mean, I don't know if you guys saw the cabin that is here, but I jumped in the cabin that is here that is meant to entertain. I mean, I'm not like, so I think, yes, I was a fan and I'm still afraid and just she bitch, don't call anyone that unless you tell them it's what it's from.
I was a huge horror fan as a kid. I always wanted to be the guy being chased by the monster and the guy saving people from the monster. So I have an opportunity to be, you know, a sidekick to a really cool guy. And to prep for the role, I just, I don't know, I worked out and watched a lot of horror movies.
He did work out a lot. You guys, wait till you see Ray's body in season 2. Can I just say...
So you know she's seen my body.
Give me $20, Ray. Ray, where's my $20?
I gave it to you last night.
Oh! Oh!
Sorry, it's Bruce is rubbing off on me. I gotta get out of here. That came out wrong. Ah. Next
I think
question,
it came out just
please.
Right.
Bruce, what was your favorite scene working with Ray or Dana in the first season?
Honestly, I was glad they just didn't turn into whiny jerks. It's true. You know, we don't know these people from Adam. They come into the audition. You ask them, are you willing to do a lot of physical stuff? What are they going to say? Not really. They go, yeah, whatever. Put us in harnesses. Fly us around. And then when they get on set, they turn into fucking assholes. It could have happened. It could have happened. They're both very sweet, still very professional. Dana asked too many goddamn questions, but that's all right. We appreciate that. I just go get a cup of coffee when they start rehearsals. And just when it's cold, stone cold, I know we'll be ready to shoot. Ray had to put up with quite a bit this year. He was naked and tattooed and hog-tied, and for those of you who dig that sort of stuff, it's going to be a good year for you, too.
So mostly I'm that, and I'm grateful to also, you know, Lucy for providing. She's a TV star and an icon in her own right. And she has helped me very much maintain an even keel on the set because she's so polite to everybody all the time. And it's infuriating. Because I just want to say, is this a staring contest? Come on, let's get going here. And she'd go, Bruce, you can see they're very busy over there doing some very challenging work. Perhaps you could just shut your mouth and just wait for them to do this difficult stuff. And I go, oh yeah, I could do that. And Lee did two series where he had an apartment on the back lot because they'd work him 47 hours and go, hey, we got your room. Oh, thanks. And he'd go up and crash, and 2 hours later, he'd be working again. Lee is a very good representative of actors, too, because he learns his lines, doesn't like it if you change it, your lines, and don't tell him, and he never leaves the set. But like, Lee, it smells like ass on this set. Why don't you go back to your trailer? No, I'm good. Ted, you do a better Lee than me. How would he do it?
Lee kind of sounds like this.
Yep. Now, Lee's very demure in front of audiences, I'm sure you know.
Lee, why don't you go sit down back in your trailer?
No, I'm good sitting here, man. I'm fine.
Lee, can I get you a cup of coffee?
No, that's crap, man. I had worse coffee on...
Are you hungry, Lee?
I had worse coffee on $6 Million Man. I don't want any of that crap right now. Tell you what, when I did Fall Guy, it was better doing Fall Guy 6 years and one day with you, Campbell. I'll tell you something.
I don't think he ever said that, Ted.
Oh, you sure
I
did?
I don't think he ever said that.
Lee?
I'm grateful for all of these cast members. I think that's what it is. And honestly, I make fun of Ted relentlessly because it's so easy. But it's very nice to get him back on a set and to be working with him again. You know, we did try in the first season to keep him away, and we succeeded. But second season, we just were like, this is stupid. Where's Ted? We got to torment somebody else on this show.
Yeah, you'd think after 30 years I'd be treated a little better, you know, but it just gets worse and worse and worse.
Yeah.
Like some kind of hell, I tell you what. Whatever. You think there's no respect, but there really isn't. They say 30 years ago, they go, hey, can we glue all this crap to your face and pay you nothing? I went, well, I guess, sure, I'm a 20-year-old kid. That's a good idea. Now I'm 50. I go, yeah, that's a good idea. I'm moving up in the world from what I don't know.
Do we have, man, you're right kind of halfway in the back there. You're next to the guy who, swear to God, is dressed like Michael Jackson. Are you dressed like Michael Jackson? Oh, like Michael Jackson. Michael Jackson was a Star Lord.
Bruce, many years ago at a ZNEX convention here in San Diego, you said you would play the role of Ash again when monkeys flew out your butt.
Very little monkeys.
Well, guess what? They did. It wasn't as bad as I thought it would be. What's that? Yeah, when those monkeys start flying out, something's going on.
All right. Back to the microphone.
This is a question for Sam, Ted, and Bruce. The people have been around Ash the most. For the entire franchise of The Evil Dead, several Deadites have threatened to consume and swallow Ash's soul. So I was wondering, what do you believe is the culinary equivalent of Ash's soul?
What?
Are you in medical school?
No.
That is the best question I've ever heard.
I think the man who created this is really the most suited to answer this.
I never thought I'd see you deflect a question, Bruce Campbell.
Could I have a multiple choice?
Do you want the money? Are you going to pay out?
No, I'm not going to pay. So you mean because those creatures are always saying, swallow your soul, swallow your soul.
Which was Sam's voice, by the way.
Yeah, that is his voice.
So you want to know, do you think his soul has been swallowed by previous creatures?
No, if they had swallowed his soul, what would it taste like?
Oh, what would it be like? Oh, I see. That's a good question.
A, ass monkeys. B, sausage. C, no, go ahead. Think for yourself.
Well, you got your answer. It's ass monkeys.
Good.
Sir in the ball cap right here.
Now that you're back, maybe we could have like a Henrietta flashback, some return of you in the terrible, awful latex.
That's right.
No,
we can't do it. We can't do it.
Maybe you can, but you just have to subscribe to Starz to find out, won't you?
You know, your whole family's going to get to ask questions. I mean, this is crazy. Okay, which one of you? We're going to get one of the Suicide Squad ladies is going to ask a question. Dad, you decide. Pick a favorite. Look, dude, I don't want to get into that. But you do have the entire Suicide Squad as your kids. So, okay, both of you. So, Haley first. Okay, who's it for? Of course it's for Bruce, right? Because you want the money.
What character are you?
I'm Harley Quinn.
Harley Quinn. Why? She's your favorite. Why is she your favorite? She's ditzy and dumb, and that's your favorite? What kind of a role model is that? Come on, Dad. Jesus Christ. A ditzy and dumb kid and a serial killer. Have you been arrested, sir, before? Are you a serial criminal?
Yeah.
Jeez. Okay, sorry. So you like the character because she's stupid. Are you stupid? Are you a smart little kid? You're honorable?
Oh. Honor roll.
Honor roll.
Honor roll.
You're on a roll? Yeah, you're on a roll. Oh, you're on a roll. Honor roll. What grade are you in? Why are you here? Dad. All right, sorry, Harley. What's your dumb question? Nice and loud.
What piqued your interest into becoming Ash?
What piqued my interest into becoming Ash? I did never intend to become Ash. I made a movie a long, long time ago. And that's all people remember of everything that I've ever done. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Harley, in case you don't know this, I played Coach Boomer on Sky High. Yeah. Yeah. Movies that you should be watching. I'm in Cars 2, for God's sake. I'm the mayor in Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs, but your stupid family, that's all they care about, is Ash. I've been in a French film. I played a cowboy. I played the King of Thieves. And all you and your dumb family care about is Ash. So what piqued my interest is I had a dream one night. More of a nightmare, actually. That said, you're going to be getting questions like that for the rest of your life. So now guess what, kid? I'm going to play Ash until you're about 50 years old. Take that crap off your face. Go get a job at Starbucks, sure. Sure, Starbucks. And I hope you stay on the honor roll. This is for the honor roll. Oh, we better go
right.
To the other
now,
kid.
Now it's your turn.
Yeah, now the other sister. Stop capitalizing, Dad. Stop it.
All right, now it's your turn.
Yeah.
How old are you?
Did we ever have a dream and did we pursue it? We are living proof that when you have a dream and you hustle and you work and you work and you follow your passion, you can achieve your dream. That's the truth. I mean, really. I mean, and if you look at the creators of the show, someone else was talking about, you know, how you sold your show by going into grocery stores after hours to show the very first film, to get the first film made. And it's that kind of hustle. And if you love something, do it. Find a way to do it in any which way. And if it makes you happy, answer every call that excites your spirit, my friend.
Hey, kid, what do you want to be when you grow up? A tattoo artist.
Yeah.
You're reaching for the stars, I can see.
Did not see that coming.
Listen, I'm out of 20s. So come here and get what I got. Let's go with like $13. Get that crap off your face. Dad, sit down. Oh, I got my, give me that. Give me that back. Thanks, Lucy. I appreciate that. I'll square up with you later.
All right, Madame, here at the microphone.
Hey, this question is for Ted, Lucy, and Bruce. After 30 years, you got Jockster, you got Xena, and you got the King of Thieves together. How has that changed your working relationship? After 30 years.
I used to worship Bruce.
Oh.
No, I didn't really worship Bruce. But Rob put me together with Bruce at the beginning of Xena to teach me how to be a good little star. And now that he's a grumpy old man, I'm feeding back as... You know, one thing he taught me is really magical is when they say, Lucy, you're up, and you're like, it's freezing, it's wet, you're covered in blood, you're cross, you're tired, whatever. He would go, excellent. Or I'd hope you were going to say that, and I do that. I've done that my entire career since he used to do it. And yeah, now you've forgotten, but you had a huge impact.
I'll get back to it, Lucy. I'll be so enthusiastic. Seasons 3 and 4.
If you subscribe to Starz. I was hoping you'd say that.
Lee, I have a question for you. If Bruce gets his way with season 3 and 4, will you come back?
Are you talking to me?
I'm talking to you. Yeah, I know.
I got a question. Well, now you can see why I joined this show with this entertainment on the set all the time. Who could help but not want to be there? It's wonderful. Isn't he great?
Now, Lee.
But I will be back if I'm asked.
Okay, that was good. Answer that, yeah.
If they subscribed enough this year to get us back.
All right, we're going in the middle now. You've had your hand up from the beginning, so come on. Okay, no, maybe not.
All right, my question is for Sam and Bruce. What has it been like revisiting the franchise that you created and the character that you took off running?
You first, Brucey.
The last time we did an Evil Dead movie was 25 years ago. And Sam's directed a lot in that 25-year period, and I've acted a lot in that 25-year period. So it was actually great to come back together again and go, well, Sam, you've learned a few new tricks. And I think he said the same of me, I don't know, but...
I said, you've played other parts in the meantime since? Have you, Brucey?
Oh, too soon.
Ouch. Ouch.
But
that's right.
I had a wonderful time working with Bruce. Because he hadn't worked in like 25 years. So he was very appreciative to have that role again.
You know, I heard Sam was going to go do Quick and the Dead. He's going to direct Quick and the Dead. Russell Crowe. Sharon Stone, Gene Hackman, Leonardo DiCaprio. I'm like, Sam, you gonna hit Gene Hackman with a 2x4? You gonna poke him with a stick? This comes out of Sam's mouth when you finish a take. He goes, that was great for somebody else's movie. You gonna say that to Gene Hackman? No, I don't think so. And cut. That was great. If this was a miniseries.
Bruce, I gave you a role on when you came down to Quicken the Dead, didn't I?
Yeah. I had one day off on The Adventures of Briscoe County Jr. One day off. Sam's making a Western. This is perfect. It's perfect. I'll go visit him and we'll sit behind the monitors and laugh while he directs all these famous people. I show up, he goes, come here, buddy, come here. Come on over here to the wardrobe department. I'm like, oh, no, I'm only here to visit. Come over here. Drags me in there. Okay, I want you to make him up like he used to have money. Now he doesn't, like he's got syphilis. Well, no, don't, Sam. I'm here to visit and drink coffee and crack jokes. No, come here. Let's go to the makeup department. Brings me in there. Make him look like he's homeless. You can do cold sores really good, right? Give him a cold sore, like right there. Yeah. Okay, come here. What are we doing, Sam? Shut up. Come on, let's go. We go to the set. There's a guy named Pat Hingle, a very famous character actor. He's been in 7,000 movies, and he's been hassling Sam mercilessly because in the movie, Pat Hingle's daughter gets sort of sold off into becoming a prostitute by this really sleazy guy. And Pat Hingle kept going, Sam, my character doesn't do anything about that, and my character would. Blah, blah, blah. This went on for weeks, apparently. Yeah. Sam sees me. He gets the idea. We're going to shoot a scene, Pat. Pat, come here. I want you to meet this guy, Bruce. He's like a stuntman. Don't worry about it. Okay, Bruce, you're going to come up to the girl. And you're going to say, hey, girly girl, we're going to do the devil's dance. And then Pat, he's coming after your daughter. You get in there and you go, you stay away from my daughter. And you turn around and you kick him in the ass. And Pat, I mean, you kick him. He's got padding on. Look at that ass. He's got padding. You kick him, Pat. And Pat, he doesn't know me for shit. He goes, yeah, okay. We did 10 takes of this. Each time, Pat kicking me harder. And Sam goes, doesn't seem like you're really stopping him and turning him. He grabs me around the neck before he starts kicking me. Pat finally looks at Sam, very satisfied, walks away. Sam comes over to me and goes, thanks a lot, Bruce. We're not even going to print the film. But because I signed the paperwork, I had to come up with, they had to call me something. So we put wedding shimp. Because they're in one sequence, supposedly I'm holding a beer from some crazy high shot that I think you can see me with mega HD Blu-ray pausing with a mic or something. So, yeah, that's how Sam directs me. Yeah. I sure missed all that.
Are you going to respond to that?
Well, it made Pat Hingle very happy. Well, here was an actor that had a real passion. You know, he had seen his daughter be abused, and he wanted some justice. And I could really relate to that. And every day he got madder and madder because he kept saying to me, Sam, I'd do something about this. And I kept saying, no, you wouldn't, Pat. It says in the script you wouldn't. And then when Bruce visited me, I realized Pat was right. Justice needed to be served. So actors do enlighten directors all the time. And that was such an instance for me, an eye-opener.
Man with a hat right there. You have to stand up.
This question is for all the actors. Like, what do you guys do on your time off, like, to relax and then have a couple days off and then come back to, like, mentally stay
and start recording again? Hospital visits. Short hospital visits. These guys to kill themselves. These guys, absolutely. Bruce, Dana, and Ray, I've never seen three actors destroy themselves for any TV show I've ever worked on in my life. I've starred in two and guest starred in about three or four dozen. This show is murder on them. They came, I don't know how they lived through it. It's amazing.
I have a stuntman I would like to say thank you to. Raisho Vezilev. Let's all say that together. Raisho Vezilev.
Excuse me, I'll cry inside.
He's from Bulgaria, and he's a very busy stuntman. Thank you, Raisho. I acknowledge your existence. You do help me out. I will not say that I do all my own stunts, because you do a lot, and you hurt yourself every day. Thank you, Raisho. Raisho Vezilev. Vezilev.
Dana, Ray, what do you do to relax?
We just really just throw blood on ourselves just to keep us, you know, in the zone of the show
the
until season 3 and 4 air and get picked up. That didn't work as well as I thought it was. It was really going to land, and it didn't. What do we do? Actually, you know what's really great about the show is we hang out. Like, the cast hangs out all the time. Like, we were shooting a lot of 6-day weeks this season because it's packed with so much intensity. And, I mean, Bruce and his wife, Ida, were the presidents of the social, Ash vs. Evil Dead Social Committee Club. Is that what you were calling
Just
it?
Just say we party. We party when we don't have to work, and we work when we have to work.
We hang out with each other. You know, I think that's a great, that's just, anyway. I love you guys. That's all I have to say. Never mind. I'm trying to have a moment. Ray, we're telling how much we love each other. Like last night.
I'm in trouble.
Lucy, what do you do?
I,
No, Lucy, what do you do to relax?
I watch episodes of T.J. Hooker.
You should have said Fall Guy.
Oh, crap. That's right. And Fall Guy.
Lee, how about you? What do you do to relax when you guys are on set?
I'm usually preparing for another project. In case you guys don't subscribe enough.
So, Lucy, you never told us what you do.
I'm relaxed at all times.
No. I'll say something for Lucy. I'm going to prompt you, and you can tell the story.
Oh, what?
You peek into the bowels of the American justice system when you're not working.
Oh, yeah. I watch murder trials. I mean, I actually go to the courts and watch murder trials.
Wow, that was a good one. Did you see how they put that guy away?
I saw this trial of a guy who cut off his estranged wife's head with a box cutter. And I was in this wacky little town. I won't say exactly where. Rhymes with Louisiana. Turns out they have the best hospital in the state where they do all the accreditations for all the surgeons. They stitched her head back on, and she testified. I was working that day. I couldn't watch it. But the trial's so astonishing. You can't believe what it's... anyway, yeah, that's what I do.
We have time for one more question.
It's so chill.
It has to be you.
My name's Max, and Lucy, you are one of my biggest heroes. But this question is for Sam, Ted, and Bruce. I'm going to...
You got any more money?
None taken.
Okay, well, I'm an... I want to become a movie maker and a director, and everything that you guys have done to make the original Evil Dead is so inspiring, but I got to know what kept you going to make the original movie.
I think that's a question for Sam. Sam, why don't you answer that?
Well, thank you for that question. What kept us going was we raised money from it, so many things, personal responsibility. We dropped out of college. And our parents thought we were insane to do that. So we took jobs as busboys, janitors, cab drivers, and we would work to raise money to hire the attorneys to put together this private placement memorandum. Then we took that around, raised money from different individual investors, doctors and dentists. We would show the little movie that we had made called Within the Woods. It was like a precursor to Evil Dead. So by this time, we had so many expectations upon us. Our parents were upset with us because we dropped out of school. The attorneys had spent time working with us. They had expectations. It was basically a lot of responsibility started to fall upon our shoulders. We had to do this thing. And our own sense of ourselves, this is what we told ourselves we were alive for, to make movies. We'd do anything to make this movie. And sometimes we'd give up hope, and that's why having a partner was great. They'd pick you up and say, no, we can still do this. Don't worry. I know it's been a few months since we got our last investor, but we can make it happen. So what made it do it was a combination of the love for making movies, the friendships that we had, and the sense of growing responsibility as we move further down this path, we had nowhere else to go. It was inevitable.
It's the best answer you could get. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking the producers and the cast of Ash vs. Evil Dead.
Thank you.
And a special applause again for Mr. Lee.